Today we will talk about cerebrovascular diseases. The diseases of the nervous system are neurologic diseases, and the most common of them among them are nutritional disorders, for example vitamin B deficiencies, vitamin C deficiencies, iron deficiencies, and they causes various neurologic problems like neuropathies. Second most common are migraine. Third is trauma directly to the nervous system, for example brain trauma or for example spinal cord trauma. Then the third most common neurologic diseases are cerebrovascular diseases. So today we are going to talk about cerebrovascular diseases and some of the cerebrovascular diseases. So the cerebrovascular diseases consist of the stroke and the cerebrovascular anomalies. Cerebrovascular anomalies like intracranial aneurysms and arteriovenous malformations, these are the vascular anomalies which leads to the rupture of the arteries. Intracranial aneurysms are the weakened portion of the arteries, and arteriovenous malformations are the malformations of the arterial and the venous junctions. So these lead to the rupture of the arteries, and rupture of the arteries is stroke. Stroke is of two types, ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. So let us look at the definition of stroke. Stroke is also called as cerebrovascular accident. It is the abrupt onset of a neurologic deficit that is attributable to a focal vascular cause. Right? Abrupt means sudden. It is a sudden onset of neurologic deficit. That means the nervous deficiencies will be there in the body. For example, there will be problem in the sensations, there will be motor problems, or there will be consciousness problems, right? So neurological deficits which are attributable to a focal vascular cause. Focal here means local, or a particular vascular cause, particular to a particular blood vessel. So because of the blood vessel problems, there will be a neurological deficit which will be sudden in onset. So that is called a stroke. So abrupt onset of a neurologic deficit which is attributable to a focal vascular cause. The risk factors for the stroke, the most important risk factor is the hypertension, especially for the second type of stroke, the hemorrhagic stroke. Age, male sex, and alcohol. Tobacco smoking, diabetes, obesity, physical inactivity, infections, genetic polymorphisms means genetic predispositions, and atrial fibrillations where the atrias don't contract properly, they just fibrillate. This leads to the circulation problem. Age, male sex, and alcohol, right? These are repetitions. They are especially for the this hemorrhagic stroke, whereas others are all others are common for both. Right, ischemic heart disease, the main risk factor was dyslipidemia, whereas for stroke the main risk factor is hypertension. Stroke can be categorized under minor stroke, stroke in evolution, or completed stroke. So minor stroke is a stroke which is very little, which is insignificant, and the recovery is complete within a week. That means after an attack, the patient recovers completely within a week. So that is called as a minor stroke. Stroke in evolution is a stroke which is progressive with time. That means the stroke symptoms are progressively increasing day by day, so that is called a stroke in evolution. Completed stroke is a stroke where the maximal deficit has happened and the person is no longer in a progression and the maximum damage has been already been done, right? So this way we can categorize the stroke. Next are the types of stroke. Now the stroke is basically divided into two categories. One is ischemic stroke and number two is hemorrhagic stroke. There is another category of stroke which is called as transient ischemic attack, TIA. Cerebral ischemia leads to stroke. When this cerebral ischemia is temporary and is restored either by the body or either by the medical fraternity, right, and it leads to complete resolution of the temporary neurologic sign and symptoms, right, especially within 24 hours, so that is called as transient ischemic attack. Or in other words, if the stroke is reversed completely in 24 hours, then we don't call that thing as stroke, we call that as transient ischemic attack. The definition of the stroke is little different. When the neurologic sign and symptoms last for greater than 24 hours, greater than 1 day, or the focal brain infarction is demonstrated in imaging like CT scans, imaging like MRIs. If brain infarction is demonstrated or neurological sign and symptoms last greater than 24 hours, then we call that as stroke. Otherwise, before 24 hours, if the symptoms appear and then they disappear, we call that as transient ischemic attack. So stroke is of two types, ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. Now this ischemic stroke is the major prevalent stroke, which is found 80%. The stroke causes, the ischemic stroke is the cause for 80% of the total stroke, whereas the hemorrhage stroke is 20%, and hemorrhage is again divided into subarachnoid hemorrhage and intracerebral hemorrhage. You can see in this picture there are layers of the brain. If the bleeding is in the arachnoid, right below the arachnoid membrane, then it is called a subarachnoid membrane, which leads to the intracranial pressure and damage to the brain tissue, right? Second is intracerebral hemorrhage, where the blood vessels inside the cerebrum, they rupture and causes leakage of blood in the brain, right? Third is ischemic stroke, where the blood vessel becomes stenosed, leads to deficiency in the blood flow. So quick recap of the blood circulation of the brain, of the head, right? So the arc of aorta dividing into common carotid, right, first, and then subclavian. The common carotid is going to the head region, common carotid again dividing into external carotid and internal carotid going into the anterior aspect of the brain and consists of anterior circulation, whereas the second branch of the brachiocephalic is subclavian. Second branch from the subclavian is the vertebral artery, and this vertebral artery is going through the vertebras and is becoming a basilar artery and is supplying to the posterior part of the brain. So the vertebrobasilar arteries, they are supplying to the posterior part, whereas the internal carotid is supplying to the anterior part of the brain. So this internal carotid consists of anterior circulation, whereas the vertebrobasilar consists of the posterior circulation of the brain. So this is the circle of Willis. The internal carotid and the vertebral artery, vertebrobasilar artery, they join to form a circle of Willis, right? So you can see here, this is common carotid, the right side, right common carotid. It is dividing into external carotid, internal carotid. Internal carotid is going and supplying to the posterior part through the posterior communicating artery and to the posterior cerebral artery, right? This posterior cerebral artery is joined with the vertebral artery, right? The vertebral artery from here is coming, it is giving spinal arteries, and this vertebral artery from the right and left is joining to form a basilar artery, and basilar artery is again giving this posterior cerebral artery, right? Similarly, this internal carotid is giving anterior cerebral artery, and towards the middle it is giving the middle cerebral artery. So let us talk about the ischemic stroke first. So cerebral ischemia is the same as we have studied in the heart diseases. Cerebral ischemia is the reduction in blood flow which lasts for more than few seconds, and if it lasts for more than few seconds, neurological symptoms manifests, right? Because we know that the neurons, they lack glycogen and they need rapid supply of oxygen and glucose, right? So the cessation of blood flow, the stoppage of blood flow for more than few minutes, leads to death of brain tissue, that is brain infarction. So ischemic stroke, the causes for ischemic stroke are, the most important causes are, number one, atherothromboembolisms, which are 50% of the causes. Now this is the same as that of the heart diseases, atherothromboembolisms, where the atheromatous plaques in the arteries, they lead to the formation of thrombus right upon them, and that thrombus leads to the occlusion of the arteries, and that leads to the ischemia, right? Sometimes this thrombus breaks away and causes thromboembolisms, right? So these atherothrombotic diseases of some extracranial blood vessels and some large intracranial arteries are responsible for the major reasons for ischemic stroke. Extracranial blood vessels like carotids and the vertebral arteries, whereas the large intracranial arteries like intracranial means inside the cranium, like cerebral arteries, right, middle cerebral arteries or anterior cerebral arteries, posterior cerebral arteries. So these blood vessels, they go atheromatous changes, and these atheromatous changes, when superimposed by the thrombotic changes, leads to atherothromboembolisms, right? So second cause is intracranial small vessel disease. It is 25% of the cause. Intracranial small vessel means the small vessels of the brain, right? Small vessels of the brain, when they are occluded because of the same reason, atherothrombotic or lipohyalinotic occlusions, that is the deposition of the lipids and the hyalines, right, that causes a stroke, a different category of stroke, which is called as lacunar stroke or small vessel stroke. The new definition is, the new term is small vessel stroke. Thrombosis of these vessels causes small infarcts, which are referred to as lacunes. Lacunes or lakes. So they causes small infarction areas. So you can see the most commonly involved small vessel is the middle cerebral artery, right? So this is the internal carotid, the right internal carotid, and this is the left internal carotid, and they are making the middle cerebral artery, right? Middle cerebral artery of the right side, middle cerebral artery of the left side, and this middle cerebral artery is giving small arteries less than 1 millimeter. These are called as lenticulostriate arteries, right? These are the major sites of occlusions and infarctions, and such small infarctions are called as lacunar stroke, right? So occlusion of these small vessels and other small vessels also from this circle of Willis or from the vertebral arteries itself, from the basilar arteries itself, these small blood vessels, when they are occluded, then a different category of stroke, a lacunar stroke, is formed. The third causes for ischemic stroke is cardiac source of embolisms, when the heart become the source of embolus formations, right? The heart diseases, for example MI, for example, most common is atrial fibrillations or the prosthetic means artificial valves or rheumatic heart disease or cardiomyopathies, right? These leads to the formation of thrombus inside the heart, and that thrombus travels through the carotid arteries into the brain and causes thromboembolisms, right? So these are called as cardiac source of embolisms. Then there are certain rare causes where some people have hypercoagulable disorders because of some genetic deficiencies, for example protein S deficiencies, homocysteinemia, sickle cell anemia also leads to increased coagulability, beta thalassemia, antithrombin deficiencies, and so many, right? Some particular drugs, some recreational drugs like amphetamines, cocaine, they leads to the hypercoagulability. Vasculitis also leads to the hypercoagulability disorders. So these are the rare causes. Now let us see the pathophysiology. Pathophysiology is more or less the same as that of the ischemic heart diseases. So the acute occlusion of intracranial blood vessels leads to the reduction in blood flow, and which leads to cerebral ischemia. When this cerebral ischemia is prolonged, it leads to the necrosis by starving the neurons from glucose and oxygen. And when oxygen and glucose is less, then the mitochondria, it fails to generate ATP. And when ATP is less, then the sodium potassium pump fails, which leads to the increase in intracellular calcium and degradation of the mitochondria, degradation of the membranes, and this mitochondria start producing certain proteolytic enzymes, certain free radicals, which causes the catalytic destruction of the complete cells, right, and thereby hampering the vital functions of the brain, right? If the blood flow is restored before the cell death, before cerebral infarction, the patient experiences only transient symptoms, only temporary symptoms, and they are completely reversible, just like angina, and this is called as TIA, transient ischemic attack. If the cerebral ischemia progresses to infarction, then there is a central core of the infarction, and it is surrounded by a group of cells which can still be reversed, and those group of cells are called as, that group of cells is also called as ischemic penumbra. So we try to save that ischemic penumbra when we go to the management of this ischemic stroke, because the infarction area can no longer be revert back, whereas this ischemic penumbra can be reverted back to the normal. So the clinical features are based on the area of the brain which is infarcted, right? So we can broadly divide the brain into anterior side, anterior and the posterior. So anterior circulation, if it is having ischemic problems, it is causing infarction, then anterior circulation strokes, and the posterior circulation. So we know that the anterior circulation is formed by the carotid arteries, internal carotid arteries, whereas the posterior circulation is formed by the vertebrobacillar arteries, so what, carotid artery or vertebrobacillar artery, right? So if anterior circulation is hampered, then it leads to ipsilateral. Ipsilateral means one side transient monoocular blindness, right? So person will go blind for few hours, few minutes, and after then again he regains his eyesight back. So that is called as amaurosis fugus. It is common in the anterior circulation transient strokes. Then contralateral side, the contralateral means the opposite side, hemiparesis, right? If the left side of the brain is infarcted, then the right side of the body will become paralyzed, right? Hemiparesis is loss of strength, right? The person will gradually lose his strength of the arms and the face, the opposite side of the face and the opposite side of the arm and the legs. Hemianesthesia, there will be trouble in the sensations, right? In the half of the body, half means the one side of the arm and the leg. Hemiparesis means on half of the body. Half of the body is right, and the right arm and the right leg. Aphasia, seizures. Aphasia is the person will not be able to speak, whereas seizures are the convulsions, the motor involuntary movements. And the dysarthria is again difficulty in articulations of the tongue. So person, aphasia is when the person will not be able to speak, whereas dysarthria is when the person will not be able to speak properly, right? Basically, they are little different. Aphasia is when the person cannot make a proper sentence properly, right? He will not be able to put a sentence properly in its place. He will be randomly picking words and speaking. That is aphasia. He cannot speak a comprehensible language. Whereas dysarthria is, he will be having some problems in pronunciating certain words. So they are both speaking problems. Then vertebrobacillar tetraries are, they cause a sudden fall. The person will lose his tonicity of the muscles and will fall. Ataxia is involuntary movements, right? Involuntary coordination, the coordination of the body will be hampered. So person will not be able to coordinate his walk, his gait, or his hands, or will not be able to do certain things like dressing up. Dysarthria, speaking troubles. Vertigo is this spinning of head. Tinnitus is extra sound in the ear. Then diplopia, the person will have two visions. The person will see one object as twice. Nystagmus is involuntary shaking of the eyes. Difficulty in swallowing. That is dysphagia. Then clinical features. The lacunar stroke, if you remember, the lacunar stroke or the small vessel stroke, right? They causes the motor problems, the motor hemiparesis, right? That is half of the motor functions of the body, the hand, the right hand and the, let us say, right hand and the right leg will stop moving, or will be having less strength than the other side, Right, so the posterior limb of the internal capsule or the basis pontis, they are infected, they are infarcted. The face, arm and leg of one side is involved. That is pure motor hemiparesis. Pure sensory strokes, there are strokes which have only sensory abnormalities. That is due to the infarction in the ventral thalamus. And ataxic hemiparesis, where the coordination of the body will not be proper. So in half of the body, so that is because of the infarction in the ventral pons. Dysarthria. And again, speaking problems and clumsy hand. The hand will not be proper. One hand will not be proper, or arm, right, because of the infarction in the ventral pons. So the lacunostrokes in these areas leads to these features. Sometimes the lacunostrokes, they leads to pure motor symptoms, pure sensory symptoms, some ataxic symptoms, or dysarthria, only speaking problems, and that is because of the infarction in these areas. And these lacunostrokes have the best prognosis. And they are the most common in the old age. And the major reason for these lacunostrokes are because of the hypertension and the age. Then the hemorrhagic stroke. So the biggest risk factor for a hemorrhagic stroke is hypertension. The increased blood pressure leads to the rupture of the arteries, either inside the brain, intracranial, or below the arachnoid, subarachnoid membranes, and leading to subarachnoid hemorrhage. So intracranial hemorrhage consists of three things. First is hemorrhage into the subdural and epidural spaces, right? When somebody has a trauma over the head, it leads to the subdural and epidural hemorrhage, right? Subdural and epidural hemorrhage hardly causes the stroke, so they are not included here. Whereas the subarachnoid hemorrhage compresses the brain tissue and causes stroke. So subarachnoid hemorrhage and intracerebral hemorrhage, when the blood vessels inside the brain, they rupture, that is called as intracerebral hemorrhage. So hypertension is the more common, most causative factor, whereas others are bleeding disorders, platelet disorders, aneurysms of the arteries, especially in the brain and in the subarachnoid membranes, arteriovenous malformations, especially in the subarachnoid membranes. Then these produces neurological symptoms by compressing the neural structures, or by producing some toxic effects because of the blood, because of the spilled blood, and by intracranial pressure, increasing the intracranial pressure. That is why decompression craniotomy is done. Decompression craniotomy is done. Then pathophysiology. So the hypertensive intracerebral hemorrhage, it results from the spontaneous rupture of small penetrating arteries of deep in the brain. The most common sites are basal ganglia, especially the putamen, the thalamus, cerebellum and the pons. The hemorrhage may be small or large, and it may compress the adjacent tissue accordingly, and it causes herniation of the brain, and it sometime, if it is severe, it can cause immediate death also. The most important cause for morbidity among the diseases are heart disease, and the second is stroke. Whereas for the disability, the most important cause is the stroke. So clinical features of hemorrhagic stroke are severe headache. The person will feel severe headache because of the rupture of the blood vessel, vomiting, seizures, right? Because of the intracranial pressure, raised intracranial pressure, the person will be having vomitings, seizures, convulsions, papilloedema, some changes in the blood vessels in the eye, then neck stiffness in subarachnoid hemorrhage, and other features are same as that of the ischemic stroke. Investigations are the complete blood count. The complete blood count to rule out certain infections, because certain infections of the brain, for example meningitis, they mimic the symptoms of the stroke. Then electrolyte disorders like hyponatremia, they also causes seizures, that can also mimic stroke. Blood sugar levels, hypoglycemia also leads to convulsions. Then platelet count causes increased bleeding tendencies. PTINR, again bleeding tendencies. CT scans, non-contrast CT scans are preferred for detecting the hemorrhage and the ischemic stroke as well. MRI scans, CT angiography to know the exact location of the thrombus or the rupture. CT angiography, CTS scans. These CTS scans are commonly done for the brain imaging. Carotid Doppler scanning. From the Doppler studies also, we can see the blood vessels, especially for the carotid arteries. देन अदर टेस्ट लाइक प्रोटीन सी, प्रोटीन एस, एंटीथ्रोम्बिन टू, होमोसिस्टिन, दे आर ऑल्सो कॉमन टू फाइंड आउट द एग्जैक्ट कॉज फॉर द स्ट्रोक. सो द एक्स्ट्रा आई हैव पुट दिस एक्स्ट्रा साइड स्लाइड्स फॉर रिमेंबरिंग द साइंस एंड सिम्टम्स ईजिली. So the early warning signs of stroke, the person will start feeling certain numbness or weakness of face, arm or leg. This is the most important warning sign. The person will come to the OPD or the emergency department, will complain of tingling sensations, numbness and the weakness of one side of the body or sometimes both side of the body. Right, person might be in a confusion state. He'll be having trouble speaking or understanding the things. Right, he'll be having trouble in seeing the eye, in trouble in walking, dizziness, loss of balance, coordination, right? So speaking will be in problem, the seeing will be in problem, the walking will be in problem, the strength of the body will be in problem, the balance will be in problem, the coordination will be in problem, right? Other symptoms like nausea, fever, vomiting, and brief loss of consciousness. If it is hemorrhagic stroke, there could be a brief loss of consciousness, right? Or there could be a decreased consciousness as well. So these are some of the common signs and symptoms which the patient explains. The primary impairments will be, first, the impairment will be in the sensations, the numbness, the paresthesias, in a hemiplegic fashion, that is in half of the body, the proprioception losses. Right, proprioception means the sense to position himself in the space, right, with eyes closed the person can tell that this is left and this is right. In these cases there it will be lost. The patient may complain of abnormal sensations like numbness, hyperesthesia or paresthesia. Pain, the person might be having increased sensitivity towards pain. For example, pinprick or contact with heat or cold, it might be intolerable with little heat or cold. And pressure also, hyperalgesia, that is called as hyperalgesia. With little pressure with your finger, the person might feel very high pain. Loud noises or bright lights, these may increase the pain, these may cause the pain. Mild irritants also trigger the pain. So the stroke can be having abnormal sensations, abnormal pain sensations. Visual changes, the person might be having hemianopsias. Hemianopsias are a visual field defect where person will see black dots in his vision, or completely one half of his vision will be gone of one eye. From one eye he will not be able to see complete visual field. Only half of the visual field will be seen, half will be seen as dark. And the tone, the body tone, the muscular tone will be lost. Right, the first the person will present with flaccidity, there will be no muscle tone. And as the time progresses, the person, that flaccidity will convert into spasticity. The blood, the body muscles will become very spastic, they'll be very hard to flex, very hard to extend, right? So flaccidity, in acute condition flaccidity, and in chronic condition this flaccidity is replaced by spasticity. So for public awareness, stroke, these FAST, FAST, are the most important signs and symptoms, where there will be changes in the face, right, deviation of the face to one side, or drooping of the eyelids, right, that is the facial palsy changes, or the weakness in the arms and the legs, right, A stands for arms and the legs, and then the speech troubles, difficulty in speech, right, and it is the time to call emergency. Thank you.